So hello everyone again. I wish you a great afternoon or a good morning wherever you are based. And I'm Svea Becker from the SAP community team, and I'm your host today. And I'm not the speaker, but I have a great speaker with me. I have Peter. And Peter, you might know already from the SAP community, and he is one of the initiators who started already in 2009 the Phoenix project, which is also known as OpenUI 5 or SAP UI 5. So Peter, I'm really happy that you're here with me, and I hand over to you. I will put my my video off so that the audience is focused on you and everyone enjoy the community call today.
Yeah, thank you, Svea, and thanks for having me today. Today in my bucket, I have some latest news from what's happening in the UI5 development, and I would like to share them with you. So you may have read already my blog post about this latest developments, and there I also give a brief insight. Today I come with a presentation where I also have demos with me to show it and to show you really what is the state of the current progress on the topics. So let's get started, and let's repeat and recap a bit where we started last year. So last year at UI5Con on air, we announced that we want to support UI5 web components as a retrofit back in OpenUI5 sub-UI5. And also what we announced is DES6 and TypeScript support. And the year has passed, and as we promised this, we want to have that definitely this year available. And that's also what I want to show to you partially on that, what has been done on our side. But let me start from my picture I really like to use to explain the things what are happening. Because when I look into the UI5 framework from a history perspective, it comes with a kind of a monolithic architecture, which was more or less a bit, let's say, sometimes unstructured. And what we are heavily working on our side is now to really bring in the structuring back and to introduce the layered architecture. And I talked about that several times at the UI5Con, and I still stick to that. This is our clear mission, to clean that up, to have a clear layering, to introduce some kind of a modular core as a foundation on top at the rendering and controls layer, having the programming model, and now aside also with the UI5 tooling, a complete different framework or tooling, which helps us to develop UI5 applications. So when looking into the modular core, you may remember, I always talk about this should become a universal toolbox. There are so many helpers and utilities inside of the UI5, in the UI5 core, which are a great value, not only for building applications with UI5, also for other frameworks. And this is also what we want to make possible, to reuse that. And working on the universal toolbox is more or less also one of the things we are doing. Another part is the universal JavaScript topic, to allow us to move things from the browser to a compile time. For example, XML processing and stuff like that, I talked about that. But they are not in focus today, and today I have two topics in the modular core environment where I really want to focus on. One is the async loading and APIs, because recently we made another progress in that direction. And the other thing, you have heard that already, is the browser support, but I come to that. So let's look into the asynchronous APIs of the framework. And for those who know that from history, we had a lot of synchronous APIs inside, which implied at the end that then resources have been loaded synchronously for sure. And we did a huge work in the framework to change that, to make it possible then that not synchronous requests, which are blocking at the end the browser, are sent out and fetch additional resources, language files, whatever, so that we are really able to make this completely unblocking and free the browser more or less from this blocking behavior with synchronous requests to get that done. We have something for components there a while now that you can load components asynchronously. Our AMD-like syntax SAP UI define require the view, the XML view, JS views, which can be created asynchronously. There is more fragments, controllers, extension points, resource bundles, version info, parameters, everywhere asynchronous APIs nowadays. Besides that, what we have as a synchronous API from the past, look into the documentation. There is a lot of available, but I want to really point you to two new things what we are doing now. And this is the create content functions, for example, in the view. And it's the create content function in the component, which are now also being able to be used asynchronously. Because this is something you may have already lacked in the past, that you want to create something, your control tree in the view or in the component asynchronously, but it wasn't possible since the contract was here to return really control. So for that, I prepared a little Plunker example. And this is the using the latest OpenUI 590 since 189 is not yet available. But luckily to the OpenUI 590, we have the snapshot available already out there. And here in that, I'm using async loading. I set data sub UI async true. So for me, one of the important steps forward to have that. And now, if we are looking into the manifest, so we are using the component support to create and instantiate our async component. And if you look into the manifest, I'm now having specified a root view, and you might miss the async attribute here because the async attribute is not required if you load the view asynchronously, the component asynchronously. And let's look into the component here, because on the component side, what we now have to add to get this asynchronous loading is to set and add a marker interface, the async content creation. And with that, if you would implement now the create content function, you can now return a promise in addition to the control. In my case, I used in the manifest the XML view, and the XML view is then also asynchronously created. So if you
are you still in the presentation?
I should be, yeah.
Yeah.
Ah.
People are complaining that there is no code, that they are not seeing any code. So I was wondering.
Oh, could it be that it's not sharing the desktop completely? Then maybe.
Now we see the application.
Do you see the Plunker? Let me.
I see the Plunker now.
I don't see the border now. Is it visible now?
We see now the Plunker with index.html and div target.
So that was my fault. So I did not check that beforehand. Okay. So maybe to briefly repeat that. The index.html having here the OpenUI 590 as a bootstrap. We use the component support to create a component. Then we use the declarative way of being the component created and the async bootstrap. In the manifest JSON, we don't need to define the async true anymore for the XML view. And in the component, we have now in the interfaces this marker interface, which says this is now a component which creates its content asynchronously. This has been added to really make the contract clear that now in the create content, you can return a promise or a control. And this is something what you can do from now on. So in this case, it creates the XML view. And here the XML view, we have also another syntax for the view creation here. This view name is starting with module column. And this indicates is that this is a type JS view, a type view. And this type view is being loaded then from this module. So you see that here a type view is then importing from a view and extending the view. And now you have also in the create content a possibility to return a promise. And this makes it now possible for you during the creation of the content to load dependencies on demand. And if I run that, then I should see two buttons, one coming from the XML view and one coming from the type view. I share this demo afterwards with you in at least in the blog post and finally, and you can take a look into that, because this is also now a great step forward in my opinion to really benefit from full asynchronous loading. Also with that one last resort here of the creation of the content, that this can be also then done finally fully async. So let's go back to the presentation. Don't waste much time. I hope you see now the presentation again. Can you please confirm?
Yes, we can see the presentation.
Because then I am safe now from now on. Thank you. So let's go and continue with that. So the other important statement from the UI5 core area is more or less the browser support change. And hooray, finally, the IE11 is dead. Yeah, for us, it's really a great step forward. You have seen that already. I think some of you also cheered in Twitter, and this is really a milestone, because from now on, we started to really remove the polyfills from UI5. In 188, we removed it from the bootstrap, and now in 189, we also even remove it from the code base, and still keep some of the modules as a placeholder that they continue to work, but then you get error messages in the log that there are placeholders just inside for that. And with that, we can now finally clean up our IE11 specific style sheet code and the JavaScript code as well. At the end, it's something which really benefits for us all, because we can now benefit from a smaller bootstrap and benefit from faster browser. We don't need to take care anymore of this IE11, which was at the end also a pretty tough browser to support. And who is the next browser which becomes the IE11? Guess? I don't say anything. Maybe some of you know that. Yeah, and at the end, this also means for UI5 application developers now that in standalone applications, not running in the Fiori Launchpad, where you maybe need to align on the version and also have maybe not the ability to load polyfills for some of all the other things, then that you can already start using ES6 plus code and also modern language features there inside. So this is something which is really possible now together with the UI5 tooling, especially for standalone applications. You can now really go ahead and benefit from all this nice modern stuff. Okay, let's go to the next layer. The next layer is talking about rendering and controls. And here in the rendering and controls, we did a lot of work also over the last years. So we have seen semantic rendering was coming, the API version 2 in the renderer, which switched from string-based rendering to DOM patching. We have CSS variables in the meantime inside, and we'll even go a bit further with CSS variables, that they will become something standard. So we plan for, let's say, 191 or onwards, that it's also possible then for together with UI5, OpenUI5, SubUI5, that you can also refer to CSS variables in your custom controls. And this will be also a major step forward when it comes to theming. So this is also something what we have on the agenda. And now let's look a bit more in the UI5 web components. So the UI5 web components, they are, as you know, the browser built-in UI element framework based on several standards. And what wouldn't be better than moving our component development or control development layer on top of web standards? And basically, for anyone who haven't heard yet about the UI5 web components, they are, from our point of view, the enterprise flavored sugar on top of native APIs. Why? Because we want to encapsulate complex controls like this date picker here and make it possible to use this date picker control together with a standard tag you can use in the browser. And this is especially something which is essential then if it comes, or if it's for the HTML developer, that you have the ability to use this tag then like that. And this encapsulates not only the visual part, it also encapsulates the behavior of the control. It comes then fully internationalized and with all accessibility features like we know also from the UI5 controls. And as it's standard, you can also use non-proprietary browser standard API to interact with that control and access the value like here with a simple DOM standard lookup. Basically, all that things, how to develop the web components, the tooling, what we have as base classes here, they are part of this UI5 web components framework. And the next step is for us really to make this possible and to share this UI5 web components tooling then also with you, that you can also use this to develop own web components on top of this framework and use that to build your component in an agnostic way, that they are not only usable for for UI5 or for React, Angular, or Vue, that they are also usable backwards, maybe for other frameworks. So here I maybe don't want to go in much detail, but I want to make you aware of a few things. So we have this playground and a lot of things have been added. I don't know whether you have seen it already. There is in the documentation section a lot of things around the assets, how to use them, the configuration guidelines. There is interesting things about scoping. I come to that in a second. And you can find for sure all the components. The new components are flagged. And since the last release candidate 13, you also have now a step input control being available here. So when looking into the web components, it's one code base at the end. We have 7 themes. We have 45 languages for the web components in WebJR translated and 57 components available here. So this is in there. And there is one interesting thing I would like to also make you aware of. It more and more comes also in discussions that the microfrontends is a topic which is there. And for microfrontends, there are specific challenges. And here Ilhan has created a nice blog post. You can also take a look into, because there is one speciality, what we also have with our UI5 web components due to the isolation they provide. We are now able to load UI5 web components also in multi versions into the browser and then supply one micro front end with, let's say, RC11 and the other micro front end with RC12. This is the scoping thing you may read, and you can also follow here in this blog post what is part of the UI5 web components, because we need to really think about the enterprise functionality with the web components. And this is really one benefit when it comes to building applications in different versions and then bring them together in one screen. So let's go ahead. But till now, mainly, and this is now coming to the retrofit part, the web components were something which was only usable for Vue, for Angular, for React, and the usage in UI5 was pretty complicated. I remember that Volker wrote last year, I think it was in March 6 or so, when I remember right, he wrote a blog post on the web components, how you can integrate them back by implementing your own control wrappers for the web component. But in the web components and with all the framework, we have this metadata available that we know what kind of events a web component has or what kind of properties and attributes a web component has. So we see that also in the bottom here, if you scroll a bit down here, we have these properties, attributes, we have the slots, which are known, the events, the slots, which are some the aggregations more or less. And this information is being used by UI5 tooling, which integrates the UI5 web components and back in OpenUI5, sub-UI5 to generate generically control wrappers for each web component. And this would be then also some kind of tooling, which would not be only available for the UI5 web components built by us. In the future, this would be also tooling, which will be available to all UI5 web components built by anyone, that the UI5 control adapters can then be generated of that. So now I give you a sneak preview on that, which will come soon. So it's the retrofit part. And you have to assume that I have synced the OpenUI5 project. And if in the OpenUI5 project, we have in the source 3 new libraries, SAP UI Web Components, Common and Fiori. They are matching the NPM packages, what we have also in the UI5 Web Components project. And now let me open the, this one is not the one I want to open, this project here. So this is the OpenUI5 repository. So maybe let's just go to the top that you all can see that. So we have here in the source, all the libraries available here. And now we see here also SAP UI Web Components as a library or Common as a library. And inside these libraries, we find the wrappers. So for example, here, the button wrapper as a control. And this is completely generated by tooling. So we have this metadata, we have the properties, and they are applied and available and directly forwarded here. So this was the main work we have done on that direction to make this easily possible, that this information is being extracted from Web Component. And then with that, we really get the control wrappers. And with the control wrappers, we are now able to connect the Web Components with the lifecycle of the UI5 programming model. Means we can benefit from the integration into our rendering flow here in OpenUI5. We can also benefit from data binding or from other programming model features like what we see here, the XML view. And what I did here as an example is, I created in the test suite of the OpenUI5 project now a small folder in which I created a component. I more or less copied the OpenUI5 sample application here, which is also available on public GitHub. And when I start this, then I can start here my OpenUI5 to-do app and now build with web components. And this was my exercise, what I did, that I looked into how can it be, how does it feel to use the web components inside the XML view and to really use these components to build the UI. One second, I make it a bit smaller, then we can see that. So here we see, this is a UI5 input here on top. This is a web component and has also the data SAP UI attributes coming from OpenUI5, where it adds some metadata to the tag. And there are more of them inside. We see the UI5 bar, we see a UI5 list. So all the things which you can see here on the screen, they are built with the UI5 web components. And now I can also interact with that. Hello world or hello watchers. Did you see my screen? Whatever, check this one, we can check now. Do you see my screen? And I can also clear, I have this picture here a bit on the side, maybe make it a bit smaller. Then I can say clear and also it works properly. So from a logic perspective, and this was the interesting part, I did not need to change anything. So the controller code behind the scenes is the same. The only thing what I changed in the application itself is that I use here now in the XML and S as a default namespace for the controls, the web components. And I use for Fiori as the web components Fiori library, and that's it. And then I start to compose it. So this requires some helper to resolve a path, yeah. But this was also in beforehand. Here I made the HTML tag because in the web components we don't have so many of the we don't have really simple layout areas, so this can be composed with HTML, therefore this isn't there, and I used a simple div to create this area for that. But then below you see also this bar, and in the bar I added the end content, like the segmented button, the input. And the input has a search icon here. In this case, I have the button here inside. And you see also data binding disabled. All the things are continuing to work as properly. You could also use the sub icon delete and stuff like that. So it feels really natural to use the web components. There are still a few things which are a bit clumsy here and there, and this need to be worked on. But overall, it really feels nice. And you can also do this aggregation binding like these items here with a path to do's. And then you have the standard list item now from web components being rendered inside. And here I played also a bit around with expression syntax to change the icon for accept or status completed here in front of the list for the checks and for the non-checks. So, and basically that's it. What I wanted to show on the current state. So there is more or less all the web components which are available in our playground are also available then as wrappers in this sneak preview here. There is some nice base class, so all web components, maybe to just recap that a bit also on that side, they are inheriting one base class from the framework, the core web component class. And this is at the end, the glue code, the magic to connect the web component finally with the UI5 programming model. So let's go ahead in the presentation. So that's what I showed. And let's go into the next layer, because I know that also there is a lot of interesting topics around in the programming model. We have, for the, some of you who have seen last time the UI5ers live, they may know already a little bit the demo, what we have seen here, because we want to talk a bit about this TypeScript and ES6 enablement for the programming model. When it comes to this TypeScript and ES6 enablement, you know this picture. We decided to go in a direction that everything which is being developed then in the future with TypeScript should follow the latest best practice and the latest JavaScript features. So we want to have the ES modules here inside. We want to also have ES classes inside. And basically the tool chain should help us to convert this code into UI5 runtime code. And that's where we are mainly working on. So we have several layers on the place where we are working on. One hand side is to establish and define this tool chain, how it looks like. And on the other hand side, what we also have to do as a work is really to clean up our TypeScript definition files. And this part for the TypeScript definition files is really the biggest work we have to do at the moment on our side. Regarding TypeScript definitions, you have to imagine within UI5, we are using heavily the JS doc to document our framework. There are issues inside for sure. And exactly these issues make it from time to time complicated then to use the JS doc information and to generate something on top. In the past, the web IDE was using the JS doc more in a proprietary fashion to provide code completion in their own editor. And with the initiative to go to Business Application Studio and are also in that direction to open it up for any editor, we decided to go in the direction of using the TypeScript definition files more or less to provide really a proper code completion support than for the UI5 development. And let's go a bit ahead. When looking into this tool chain, as I said, the tool chain is really one important part what we really focused on. This tool chain, basically, this is what you know from today. This is the classic one. You have a web app folder, you develop your application inside, then the UI5 tooling is being used to generate a distribution output. And that's the bundling and stuff like that. Now, what you want to adopt on top of that as a pre-step is to use Babel here with some plugins to enable the TypeScript compilation and the transformation of the ES Plus code into our SAP UI5 runtime or open UI5 runtime code. And this tool chain is more or less just something standard. We are reusing existing plugins for that. And now you can put the whole source code in this kind of source folder, and this Babel takes care to transpile everything into the web app folder. When we look into that demo, I have also something prepared. You can also do that on your own. I provide all this information then separately. There is this GitHub SAP samples UI5 cap event app Git repository. It's officially available. This you can clone. Then you can go into this folder for sure and check out the TypeScript branch, because in the TypeScript branch, we have added the open UI5 TypeScript definition files, the recent one, what we generate out of the JavaScript documentation. And this TypeScript definition files can then be used in the project to work and to develop the application as TypeScript. And for sure, also the tool chain, what we have seen beforehand, is configured there. So let's go there. And let's close this one here. Don't need that one anymore. So this is this UI5 CAP event app. This CAP event app project is a monorepo with several projects, but the most important place to look into is the UI form folder. Here in the UI form folder, You find then really a UI5 application. It has the index HTML. It has a component TS, the TypeScript file inside. And it also has the views as XML views and the controllers also developed in TypeScript. So the first which becomes obvious if you look into the code is really that this code is using ES modules to import the resource. And this is what we decided, that if you develop them with TypeScript, you also should use then the ES modules. And if you look a bit down, the classes should also be developed then as ES classes instead of using the UI5 class extend syntax to define them. Basically, it looks like pretty standard, like a JavaScript code, what you see here, but there are some specifics to TypeScript you notice, so that you have here typing of the properties, like the OData model. And then below here, it's assigned. You see also some places where casting is necessary, because the casting comes from the fact that this get model just returns. You see also the code completion here. I don't see it fully since I have the pictures here in front. So that you see it returns a normal model. This is the SAP UI model. And I need to cast that in an OData model to assign it properly. This can be also done in future. There are some suggestions going on with generics. We also look into that. This may make the whole thing also a bit simpler, and you can avoid then some of the casts and also in the future. But basically, when looking into that, it's not much different to writing just own JavaScript code, besides the fact that you can also use more or less code completion here. And so this OBundle has a get text and a has text function, and you get this information then from this bundle. If you go a bit down, maybe we see one or the other thing as well. Some specifics. So bind object, for example, I don't know whether we have added that already. We also want to give code completion support. Maybe I show that a bit more with a control, then we can see that. So, but first of all, let me start the server, because we built that in a way that you can really use the live reload with a watch more or less. And on the one hand side, we see then the application running. If the screen is bigger, it makes even more fun. And now if I go into my code, let's go to the component, because this is my lovely example where I exchange the create content, because then we immediately see that. Keep that here and make it a bit slimmer. So if I want to change now the content being rendered, I can now also use the create content function here. I implement that. Create content. Oops. And in the create content, I return new button. And here you get also support from code completion. Now it suggests me to import, to auto import the SAP M button for my project. And in this, I get it now also the more details like M settings are needed here. And if I open the object for the M settings and I use the code completion, I see now all the properties. I also see which one are mandatory or optional. All of them for sure are optional here, but I see here the text, for example, and this text then is a type of a string. So I need to assign a string for that. Hello world. If I save that, this tool is starting now the tool chain on with a bubble. Now it has watched that the change happened for sure. You know that. And then the rebuild takes place and the application is being updated. And if I would assign different values, like integer value, it's not a functional issue for the transpiling part now. It works also with that one, but it gives you at least a hint here in the application that something is being wrong with the type assignment. You get it as a check here. And if you would run the TS-lint now on the project, then this would also produce an error. So, but this is really one of the things which is then pretty nice, that you more or less get the, yeah, this code completion support out of the box, you know, and that you also have the auto import parts. If you would import, for example, an input, sorry, my keyboard is not anymore so good. I have this Mac issue here. Then I also see a lot of information. This dollar sub, you don't need to get nervous. This is something we are looking into improve that as well. But you see all the modules which are somehow available, and you can decide for sure which one to use. It's really, we try to make nearly everything available here. And this should be then a great help in developing apps with this TypeScript support on the future, since you get then easy as a newbie also more support in place in the IDE. You see the documentation for sure. And we will take care to improve overall the capabilities the TypeScript definition provide to simplify your development more and more. So this one you can also play around afterwards. And now let's come to another area I want to talk a bit. And this is the tooling area. In one of the last year, it was one of the main areas I was talking also about, because a lot of things happened, especially in regards to the ecosystem and the whole extensibility story here. And for sure, the tooling is and stays for us, one of the key pillars to get a modern and open development experience. We saw that also now in this TypeScript project here. I didn't show this part so much, but more or less the combination of the UI5 tooling with all the other node utilities like Babel, like whatever is there, it makes it easily possible to enhance the way how we are working. And we already have seen over the last year that with all the plugins what have been developed in and around the UI5 tooling, thanks to its extensibility capabilities, we already improved the way how we are working in a really great way. So I just want to mention this UI5 ecosystem showcase project once again, because it was the enabler at the end that you all took part in the story to improve the way how the people are working together. With this change, what we added, so that it was also in April last year, and April 1st, when we announced the UI5 tooling 2.0 with the capabilities to consume the open UI5 and SAP UI5 libraries from NPM. By having an own frontend packager, because of our challenges we faced with the versioning and to get proper versions of that. This became even more important now, the tooling, because now you could use it even for your local development offline, and you did not really need to refer to a CDN or something like this as well. And now this is what we really want to have, that we want to make it possible, and I need to connect my wire now. Sorry for that.
Yeah, I think that was great that we can still see your screen.
Yeah. So,
and the battery runneth out. Great that you saw that.
Thank you. Yeah. So that we also make it possible that the TypeScript definitions are now also available, and this is our work to really make this happen in the next month. That open UI5 TS types are available on public NPM in a actual fashion, like you have seen that in the project, and you can also play around with. And also then the SAP UI5 TypeScript types will be also available, so that at the end it's a complete experience that you can develop open UI5 or SAP UI5 applications finally with TypeScript. And last but not least, continuing in the extensibility of the UI5 tooling is key. This is also one thing we need to look into. At the moment, we have a lot of challenges with the changes of our internal build platform. This is something we are looking at the moment, that this also moves to the UI5 tooling completely. And the next step afterwards would be also, for example, looking into something like this, that it's easily possible that we have also command extensibility, like I explained already in the past, where you can have own commands like create or let's say a deploy command, and you do something like this. I recently have also seen that Florian Pfeiffer, he also provided a blog about a deploy command as a CLI. This would be also great to incorporate it and somehow with a command extensibility in the future. And this is then something we can also look into once this is there. And for sure, type extensibility. If we go also in the direction of having a web components project being built with the UI5 tooling, then and even other projects, then the type extensibility is also a pretty interesting part, because then we can more or less also orchestrate the tasks and tools happening there. One thing I would like to mention here is one thing we did a while back. We moved the UI5 ecosystem showcase repository to the UI5 community, and this brings me to one other part. This UI5 community GitHub organization, what we have started here. This should be really a central place where we have the chance to share custom tasks, custom middlewares, also custom controls, libraries, and other sample applications with each other in a way that we can learn from each other. And what wouldn't be a best place than having something like this common GitHub repository being available? And this just started. There's nothing completely carved in stone on this ecosystem showcase repository and even the community. So we can really work on that. If you have ideas with that, also reach out to me. And I think we showed also in the past with several projects, which we have done together with you guys from the community, that we can really also do things together, make something bigger, even bigger out of that. And have then also a great experience, which can be shared at the end with all of us. So that's what I wanted to say regarding this. And the move of the UI5 ecosystem showcase projects, which was on my personal GitHub beforehand, to the community and to have a shared responsibility with that, was just one of the assets happening. Let's come back again once more to this UI5 tooling and to the ecosystem evolution here, because there happened recently also one thing. I don't know whether you have seen that. It happened with regards to scaffolding. And this also is one of the things which makes me proud, since this is not only one thing which have been started by the UI5 team. It's more or less that it's something which has been started by Marius Obert in the past with the EC UI5 generator. Also, we from the SAP UI5 team developed their own generator in the past to provide templates which were available in the web IDE, also as a Yeoman template to you as a NPM and Yeoman package. But now, I think after some discussions and some special things happened, that happened even something bigger. This EC UI5 generator has been enhanced in a way with a 3.0 release that it's now becoming a generator which can consume the generators being developed by us as a community in the UI5 community GitHub organization and make them available to everyone. And just to show a bit how this looks like, I started that already. So it's a YoEC UI5. And if you have installed the latest version, the 3.0 version, it will now provide you a list of generators. Marius calls them plugin generators, which are at the end nothing else than projects in the Yeoman projects in the UI5 community GitHub organization. And they are developed together. So the generator UI5 library, which has been developed by Gert-Jan, the generator UI5 control, which has been developed by Volker, and the generator UI5 project, which is more or less the old content from the EC UI5 generator, which was somehow built in the classic EC UI5 generator. This has been now made available as a separate generator and also available in a way that we can work on and develop that together so that every one of us can more or less incorporate his changes there and can also apply his best practices to that, and we can discuss that in general. And it also solves one thing, that we are not at the end the bottleneck anymore. In one project, we can redistribute and reorganize and the responsibilities of individual assets. And this is also another thing which I say, it's also kind of an ecosystem now. It's an ecosystem for the generators here, which is also a great step forward. So we are now establishing the next ecosystem besides of the tooling ecosystem, where we as a community can also do some changes to the things, how people are using UI5 or developing UI5 together in a joint way. And last but not least, you may now ask yourself, how does all this fit together? Yeah, good question. But to answer this question, I would really say, wait for the UI5 Con on Air 2021. It will take place in June 16, June 17. It's not yet open. Go to UI5Con.org to check when it's open. We also will send out some tweets and news once you can register for it. And because exactly there at the keynote of the UI5Con on Air, I want to really go in the direction to connect all these pieces here and to show you how all this can work together to create a really great development experience at the end for us all to have a kind of a great way at the end to do UI5 development. And with that, this time I'm a bit earlier finished. I would like to thank you for listening. And I'm here still for questions.
And this is really great because we have a lot of questions. So first of all, thanks very much for your presentation and the demo. So we have a lot of questions, actually. You have Margot with you by your side, so she answered already a couple of them. Mm-hmm. So let me try to read it down a little bit here, and you can also open the Q&A for you so that you can monitor it on your own, yep. Peter. So the first one would be, but async loading view should be set in manifest.json if we are working with Launchpad, right?
So if you are working with the Launchpad, definitely still. So this is also one thing which we need to discuss then how this looks finally. Because the async loading of the component also means that we need to also have the async loading enabled in general here. And this is something you should keep for the moment, but if you are on a standalone application like the one you have seen in the Blanca and you have async loading turned on, you apply this interface, you have 189 of UI5 at least available, then you can use it already that way. And the discussion with the Launchpad, we will continue on.
Okay, thank you. Armin is asking, is it also possible to use simply ES6 without TypeScript?
Definitely, this is also possible. So you don't need to have the TypeScript compilation for that. The TypeScript also provides at the end the capabilities with this proper typing of the APIs there, and that you can have a better code completion support. But with this plugin, what this Ryan Murphy had been developed, this bubble plugin, you can even use the already ES6 plus functionality already. And regarding ES6 itself, so classic ES6 APIs and language features, they can be used then also onwards with UI5 188, which is free of I11.
Okay. Another question from Daniel White. Will any sample application be developed to showcase these features? Thinking of ESPM here, this was almost at the beginning of the presentation.
So when we look into the UI5 Con, then I would say we need to have some showcase for that somehow to bring all the pieces together. So watch out and wait for the UI5 Con keynote.
Okay.
I assume that we have then also a showcase for that.
And I have also pasted the link from Margot's blog post in the chat. So if you want to catch up with the UI5Con via the blog post, you can find all information over there. Bauta was asking, do we need to have the types of the in the project itself, like in the Refence project? And he posted a link here. How will this be generated?
Right now, yes. In future, it will be an NPM package you can consume. How will this be generated? The types, the UI5 generator is to be extended to be able to generate the TypeScript definitions. It may be a bit more tricky to if it comes to custom libraries and stuff like that. These are things still to solve, but for the SAP UI5 or Open UI5 types, we have already a good breakthrough, and you see the types there. There are a few things which are not maybe still optimal and a bit clumsy, but on that we are working on.
Thank you for that. Then we have a question from Tobias. When will TypeScript be fully available and the recommended approach for developing UI5 apps?
I would say fully available. The goal is, as promised, UI5Con. Recommended approach, I would say it's your decision. We don't recommend it. It's one option, one of the possibilities you have. And if it's your decision to use TypeScript, then and your recommended approach, it's good. And I also can't await the feedback on that. If you have already the chance to play around with that, we have already some of the people who consumed or tested this TypeScript project there. And if you have feedback, we would be really happy to see that.
Okay, perfect. Here is another question. Wouldn't the UI5 TS declaration modules have the same issues regarding versioning as the UI5 code itself if consumed from NPM, or will download of the declarations be handled by the tooling?
That's also in the discussion that we definitely need to align the versioning because they are built in our with the runtime version of the UI5. So they are just build side by side. And ideally, you would also consume the types for your project in the same version as you are using the runtime version.
Thank you. Another question is, what about the deploy command from Fury tooling? Will this change as well?
We discussed this in the past already. As soon as command extensibility is there, it might be also an approach. At the moment, they are going in a different direction, having the Fiori CLI command for that. But once we are in a stage where we have opportunities at hand, we can also get in discussion here again.
Thank you. And Wouter is asking, which generator should we use in the future? The one from Fury Tooling, UI5 team, or EasyUI5?
So EasyUI5 is the one which brings the capabilities for Open UI5 and all the things what we are doing together with you as a community. The Fiori Tooling is the generator which brings in the capabilities from SubUI5, Fiori Elements, stuff like that. This is not also part of the open source delivery yet, and therefore that's still valid. I would say to have these kind of different approaches. Nevertheless, internals could be also considered to be reused across, but this is worth to discuss also in follow-ups here.
Okay, thank you. And I hope this answers Peter Janssen's questions as well. It was similar. Mm-hmm. If not, Peter, please let us know. Then Marcel has a question. Would it be technically possible to have hot module reloading known from Snowpack or Vite in the UI5 tooling?
I did not have a look into that directly. Worth to investigate. I played also around with Snowpack or Vite or Vite, however you say it. I think it's French, so Vite from okay. Fast. Yeah, definitely these tools have nice features, and we should also check out what happens there. I don't know whether it's possible from a way to integrate it and reuse it directly from the tooling, or what, or whether it's possible to integrate that somehow different. This is something really to investigate, but there are definitely nice features in there.
Okay, thank you. So Marcel, you are welcome to try it out. So I think we have time for one more question.
There is one more.
Is this application, can we do in BAS?
Okay. So if it comes to this TypeScript application, what we have seen here, or if it comes to this web components retrofit, what we have seen, they should also work in the future in Business Application Studio for sure, because the Business Application Studio is nothing else than the VS Code. The TypeScript definitions, if you think about them, they will be also available in there for the code completion. I don't see a big problem then to get that running there.
All right, thank you very much. And I also wanted to emphasize to everyone to have a look into the community, because SubUI5 is topic of the month. So there are a lot of blog posts published, a lot of information all around it. And Peter also promised to write another post about this call with this recording video, and also all the questions we could not cover here today. So I think that could be all from our side. So all the questions who could not be answered, we will cover in the blog post. Thanks very much, Peter and Margot, for being here. Peter, for your presentation.
Thank you for the invitation.
You're very welcome. And Margot, thanks for the backup here and with answering all the questions. I wish everyone a great rest of the day. Stay tuned. And I think we are definitely seeing each other at the UI5Con on air, right?
Hopefully. Thanks so much for being here today. Looking forward.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye.